Y ahora yo voy a presentar a Natalie Moguel, que es la siguiente ponente. Ella es investigadora en el Centro de Estudios Europeos de la prestigiosa Sciences Po de París. Y ella ha trabajado investigando en muchos países de Europa en materias relacionadas con las políticas sociales y es coeditora, junto a Jacqueline Palm y Bruno Palier, de un libro muy reciente en el que se analiza la cuestión que ella va a tratar, que es el paradigma del Estado social inversor. Y bueno, un poco antes de que ella empiece, sí quería decir que a la hora de organizar este seminario nos pareció muy interesante presentar y analizar este nuevo paradigma que implica una redefinición de las políticas sociales adaptándolas al escenario demográfico, económico, social y político del siglo XXI. Ella va a explicar un poco cuáles son las características básicas de ese paradigma, cuáles son también las críticas que se le han hecho y cuáles son las perspectivas de futuro que tiene la posibilidad de aplicar este paradigma que implica, entre otras muchas cosas, priorizar una serie de servicios, reorientar los servicios y también el gasto en dirección a una serie de prestaciones, intentando adaptar el estado del bienestar, tal y como lo hemos conocido hasta ahora, a las necesidades que se prevén para el siglo XXI. Y sin más, os dejo con Natalie.
This is okay. Thank you very much for inviting me. So we'll be talking about something that might seem a little more theoretical and abstract than perhaps the previous presentations, but hopefully we can draw out some more practical implications from this also. So what I'll be talking about is what has been termed by some a kind of a social investment perspective. Different terms have been used by different people, but these ideas, these different terms have kind of emerged since the late 90s, mid to late 90s, so under different labels. And they've been used by different international organizations, such as the OECD, but also the World Bank, UNICEF, and the European Union. And then there are different intellectuals and policy analysts also who have been discussing these ideas around social investment. And as I said, different labels have been used, but all these different approaches have in common a focus on policies that aim to prepare the population rather than to repair after risks have occurred. So these new ideas are based on an understanding of the welfare state. Sorry, I'm not doing this. On the welfare state, the idea that the welfare state should serve to sustain a different economy than the type of economy we've had since the post-war period. And this new economy has been termed the knowledge-based economy. And in this new economy, knowledge is considered as a driver of productivity and of economic growth. So this knowledge-based economy rests on a skilled and flexible labor force, which can easily adapt to the constantly changing needs of the economy, but also be the motor of these changes. So the social investment perspective rests on the idea of investing in human capital, but also on the idea that it is necessary to modernize the post-war welfare state so as to better address the new social risks and needs structure of contemporary societies, such as the risk of single parenthood, the need to reconcile work and family life, the lack of continuous careers, the more precarious forms of employment, and the risks associated to possessing low or obsolete skills. And this notion of social investment has also underpinned the Lisbon Agenda, which the European Union adopted in 2000 with the aim of making Europe the most dynamic and competitive knowledge-based economy in the world, capable of sustainable economic growth with more and better jobs and greater social cohesion and respect for the environment. And we find these ideas also in the new EU 2020 strategy. So as such, I think it's interesting to look in more detail at the ideas behind the social investment strategy, at the policies that are associated to the social investment strategy, and at the actual implementation of these policies in Europe so far. So to what extent have different countries followed a social investment strategy, with what successes? And is there any future for a social investment strategy in Europe in the present context of economic crisis? So these are the kind of questions I will be looking at in this presentation. So the ideas, as I mentioned, these ideas have emerged in the 1990s, and these different ideas have concerned the role and shape of social policy and its relation in relation to the economy. And there's no unified theory, actually, or no single intellectual source behind these new ideas. But all of them stress the productive potential of social policy, and that to provide a new economic rationale for social policy provision. And these ideas have developed partly as a critique of neoliberalism, but in some ways they also build on the neoliberal critique of a traditional post-war welfare state. But above all, the ideas put forward are based on an understanding that social policies need to respond to a radically changed economic and social order. The critique of neoliberal social prescriptions has stemmed from the observation of the increased the increase in polarization and in poverty rates, including of in-work poverty, which we've seen in most of Europe, and also a critique of a growing cost of social exclusion, particularly in those countries that had gone furthest in implementing neoliberal policies. At the same time, the traditional post-war male breadwinner model built in the Keynesian era has also come under criticism, not least from social policy analysts who have argued that the old welfare states are ill-equipped to deal with the transition to post-industrialism, with the social and demographic transformations of families and society, and with the resulting emergence of new social risks. So in this respect, the welfare states, especially of continental and southern Europe, have been particularly singled out as out of sync with present needs and risk structures, and for the inability to create jobs also. Likewise, the financial sustainability of these welfare states and their capacity not to mortgage the well-being of future generations has been severely questioned. So these passive social policy interventions of the traditional post-war welfare systems have also come to be presented as out of kilter with the needs of a new economy, which, as I said, is this new knowledge economy. We don't exactly know what it is yet, but that's kind of the term that's been used a lot. And it has been argued that to succeed in this knowledge-based economy, it is necessary to have a highly skilled and educated workforce, which can quickly adapt to the constantly changing needs of the economy, and which can also be the motor of this change, thanks to its creative and innovative potential. So in this thinking, the problem of unemployment is understood as being linked to a lack of adequate skills to fill today's jobs, but also a lack of adequate skills and education is expected to prevent the creation of the jobs of tomorrow, unless necessary investments are made in to foster human capital development. So these different kind of criticisms, which are both a criticism of a Keynesian post-war welfare state, but also of neoliberal policies, have led to calls for a modernization of the welfare state in order to address this issue of growing poverty and social exclusion, to respond in a better way to the new needs and new social risk structures of contemporary society, to make welfare systems sustainable, and to make them productive in the sense that they should promote and support employment and economic growth. So central to this idea is that welfare states should aim at preparing rather than at repairing the population. And the idea is also that this new architecture of the welfare state should help to minimize the intergenerational transfer of poverty. So as a result, the central thrust of a social investment perspective is that social expenditure should be reoriented from passive towards active social policies. And in that sense, the social investment perspective shares with neoliberalism the notion that social spending should be directed towards activating people in order to allow individuals and families to maintain responsibility for their well-being via market incomes rather than through passive social transfers. But while the social investment perspective retains this focus on activation that the neoliberals had instituted, there's also a shift away from the idea that any jobs are good and that social benefits should be scaled back so as to make work pay. Instead, the idea is that social policy should help to make work pay through positive economic incentives, and especially by improving net incomes for those who are at the lowest end of a wage distribution. And that it should also assist in promoting quality jobs, not just any jobs. So here, the contention of a social investment perspective is that the sustainability of the welfare state hinges on the number and on the productivity of future taxpayers. And this calls for policies that broaden the tax base by raising employment levels, but which also increase the productivity and the quality of work, and therefore increase wages and thus the tax base. So a clear argument of a social investment perspective is that investing in human capital should enable the creation of more and better jobs. The social investment perspective maintains a belief in the efficacy of a market, so that is also in the continuity of neoliberal prescriptions, but it does not acknowledge the importance of market failures and the need for government intervention and direction of market forces in order to both improve economic and social outcomes. So contrary to neoliberalism, the social investment perspective is based on a more positive theory of a state, and the state is also assigned a key role in fostering the development of human capital and in providing the necessary services and benefits to help to make efficient use of human capital and also to avoid the depletion of human capital. So while the social investment perspective displays some continuity with social thinking of neoliberalism, it does nonetheless break away from the neoliberal paradigm on a number of key points. And most importantly, it renews with the Keynesian idea that it is possible to reconcile efficiency with equity or growth with social inclusion. And the policies put forward for achieving this, however, differ from the Keynesian approach in a number of ways, because the approach is much more focused on the life cycle and on providing benefits in the future rather than on equality of outcomes in the present, which was more defining of a Keynesian era. So while the policies put forward focus on promoting equal opportunity in the present by facilitating access to education, for example, and to training, to active labor market policies, to capacitating services, this is expected to produce benefits in the future in terms of a reduction in the intergenerational transfer of poverty and inequalities, but also in terms of economic growth and employment growth. So in the social investment perspective, social policy and economic growth are not only seen as mutually reinforcing, but social policies are actually seen as a precondition for economic growth. And that's where there's a really strong shift in thinking compared to the previous paradigm. And so one could broadly define social investments as public expenditure that combines the solution of social problems with enhancing economic performance. So what kind of policies are associated to these ideas? There are, broadly speaking, three areas of public policy that stand out as particularly central. One are policies that invest in human capital development and that help to preserve human capital throughout the life course. Secondly, it's policies that help to make efficient use of human capital. And thirdly, policies that provide active securities throughout the life course. And in all these areas, capacitating social services stand out as a crucial component of a strategy that aims at preparing the population to the particular social risks caused by life course contingencies. So the focus on investing in human capital is perhaps the policy domain that has gathered the greatest consensus amongst social investment proponents. And here it receives support from various economists, and most notably from Nobel Prize winners such as Gary Becker or James Heckman, also Amartya Sen, and many others now. So here education and training policies constitute the most obvious method of improving human capital and skills. And here the focus has been very much on the need to invest in early childhood education and care, because there's a growing body of work showing that both the social and cognitive skills necessary for lifelong training are best acquired at a young age, but also that the economic returns on investment are greatest for early childhood education than for higher education, for instance. And Stephen earlier, I think it was, had showed us some data showing the return on investment for every dollar invested in childcare, for example. Here there are two elements that appear crucial for economic outcomes, such as employment growth. Such as employment growth, the capacity for workplace learning and innovation, and the development of good quality jobs. And these are both the level of enrollment and the quality of instruction. And here the data we have shows that broad-based egalitarian systems provide better economic outcomes than systems where there are heavy investments in pools of excellence, for example, but where education levels are much more unequal. And this is typically what we find in France, for example, also in the US, that is the kind of the policy that has been pursued. But what we find is that it's more in the Nordic countries, which have more broad-based egalitarian systems, that we have much better economic results also. So these investments in early human capital formation need to be accompanied by policies that help to preserve the value of human capital also throughout an individual's life course. So here what is important is lifelong training opportunities, of course, but also generous sick pay leaves and generous unemployment benefits appear to constitute an important element of a successful social investment strategy as they help to protect the value of individual skills. So, for example, well-designed unemployment insurance benefits carry the potential of also improving matching process on the labor market by working as some kind of surge subsidy, especially if they are generous but of relatively short duration and accompanied by good search, job search services and training opportunities. The second policy area relates to policies that help to make efficient use of human capital by ensuring that as many people as possible are out on the labor market. And here, of specific importance are policies that help parents to reconcile work and family life to enable women to be on the labor market. And this is important both for fostering economic growth, but also for the long-term financial sustainability of welfare systems, but also because it helps to make families less exposed to the risk of poverty when you have dual earner families. And an underlying aim of these policies is also to help families realize their desired fertility, helping women not to have to make a trade-off between work and having children. So the policies here that are typically put forward in this respect are generous parental leave schemes and widely available and good quality childcare services. But here what's important also is elderly care services to enable also women at a later age, over 50, when they become responsible for elderly parents, so as not to affect their employment patterns. And here we have some examples from Sweden where there has been some cutbacks in elderly care services, and it was followed almost immediately by a drop in the employment rates of women above the age of 55. So that is another area that's very important. Finally, the third area is policies that that help to accompany individuals through their employment career in a context where employment where careers are a lot less continuous. Here the idea is to it's not just to provide benefits that or policies that make work pay, but rather the policy imperative is for making transitions pay over the life cycle through the provision of active securities or social bridges to ensure that non-standardized employment relations become stepping stones to sustainable careers. So here, typically, generous, well-designed flexicurity policies have a role to play. So as I said, there's a fairly broad consensus around this first set of policies now, with a lot of economists from both kind of mainstream or heterodox economists pushing for investments in human capital, including for early childhood education and care. But there's a lot less agreement, even amongst social investment proponents, on the next, on the other two sets of policies. There's general agreement across Europe that the state should provide publicly funded primary and secondary education, but there's less advancement in terms of reaching consensus regarding the desirability, type, and extent of public support to enable families to reconcile work and family life, for instance. And likewise, there's a strong agreement that it's necessary to raise employment levels, but there is some ambiguity regarding the means for activating people and for promoting more flexibility on the labor market. And that ambiguity that characterizes the social investment perspective also comes out when one looks at the policies that have effectively been implemented across Europe. And here, it's some graphs that are, well, I can see there's actually on the side. So what these are graphs that show how countries from the 1980s to 2007 have been their social expenditure profile. So on the horizontal line, on the bottom, you have how much as a percentage of GDP is spent on compensatory social policies, so the like old age, sickness benefits, etc. And on the vertical line, it's not written there, but it's how much as a percentage of GDP is spent on what can be considered social investment-oriented policies. So we see that in the 1980s, Sweden is very high on the social investment side, but other countries, well, it's not very clear what the picture is. But as we go on to the 1990s, we see a shift more towards the compensatory side, and that increases more and more in the 2000 and 2007 data. And what we see is that there are kind of four worlds then of welfare states. On the bottom right-hand side, you have those countries, Spain, Portugal, Greece, Italy, are the countries that are doing a lot on the compensatory side, but very little on the investment side. And above them, you have the countries that are doing both investment and compensation. And here you have Sweden, Denmark, that are highest also on the investment, but also France, Belgium, Finland, etc. And then on the left-hand side, the top left-hand side, there's those countries such as UK, for example, also New Zealand, Norway, that are doing a lot on the investment side, but very little in terms of compensation. So what we can see is that despite the widespread discourse on the necessity to reorient welfare state spending towards more proactive forms of expenditures, the analysis of the spending profiles of welfare states shows that actually there has been an increase in public social expenditure across all countries since the 1990s, but this increase has not translated into more social investment type policies. On the contrary, it's the compensatory forms of expenditure, particularly on old age, that have increased everywhere, while the typical social investment expenditure, such as education, has actually decreased in most countries. And this decrease is partly linked to a decreasing size of the cohorts of number of students actually going through schools, but it's all, but when one considers that the length of time spent in school has increased, this still a relative, one can still see a relative decrease in spending on education. So it's only in the field of family policy that there seems to have been an increase in kind of more social investment-oriented policies, and this especially in the UK. And if one looks at both the expenditure data and also at the more qualitative data, more qualitative analysis of the policies that have actually been implemented across the different countries, it appears that it's only in the UK and in the Nordic countries that we can see some kind of shift towards social investment, but along very different lines. The Nordic version of a social investment approach spends much, as we saw, on both investment and compensation, while the British case shows a clear reorientation of public expenditure away from compensatory social policies towards more social investment types of policies, and especially it has been towards childcare and family benefits, but not actually so much towards active labour market policies. And when we look at individual policy areas, the picture becomes actually a bit more complex. In terms of investing in human capital through education, we see that the Nordic countries, along with Belgium and France, are kind of topping the charts. But France and Belgium actually do a lot more poorly if one looks at the participation rates in education and training for the adult population, so between 18 and 64, the in-work population. And here, Denmark and Sweden are really clear leaders. In 2010, for example, 38% of Danish of the Danish population in work went through some kind of further training or education, and that's only about 12% for Europe as an average. So clear differences there. Spending on family policy has increased virtually everywhere, and policies that help parents to combine work and family life and thus contribute to supporting the employment of mothers and known parents, while also helping them to reach the desired fertility, have been developing in all countries, but again, along very different lines. Again, the Nordic countries stand out for the generosity of their parental leave schemes and for the wide coverage and quality of the childcare services they provide. We have universal coverage in the Nordic countries for childcare. But there are also some new countries in which such policies were traditionally underdeveloped and which are now moving in that direction. And this is particularly true of Germany, that has introduced in 2007 a parental leave scheme that has been very much inspired by the Nordic system. And they've also started to invest quite massively in childcare services. And this is also true of the UK, not so much on the parental leave dimension, but at least in terms of investing in childcare services, according, in fact, to an explicit social investment strategy. And finally, if we look at employment policies, it's difficult to distinguish a turn towards social investment-oriented labour market policies. What we see is actually that conditionality in unemployment insurance has been increased everywhere, or in most member states anyway. Replacement rates have been decreasing, and the duration of benefits has often been shortened. So activation schemes have been far from comprehensive, but more inspired by a workfarist kind of approach. The focus has been more on counseling rather than on comprehensive. I turned this off. What some colleagues of mine have shown is that the quality of activation services has not lived up to the kind of social investment ideal that was supposed to be inherent in the European employment strategy. And then the reform of education, activation, and training has been quite limited across member countries. And data shows actually, if we look in a historical perspective, that there was more a greater social investment orientation to active labor market policies in the 1950s and 60s across Europe than there is today. So while the social investment strategy seems to have had only a very partial impact on recent reform trends in most European welfare states, there are nonetheless some good reasons for not discarding it as a strategy for the future. Indeed, one sees that there are also some success stories for the social investment approach. And here, the experience of the Nordic countries, where a social investment strategy has been pursued for a longer time, suggests that social investment policies can be used to successfully combine social and economic goals. What we see is that these countries display high and broad-based education levels, which also... which also appear to translate into high levels of social capital and social cohesion, into greater learning and innovative capacity at the workplace. They have higher female employment rates, more flexibility on the labor market, lower poverty rates, lower transmission of intergenerational poverty, also higher social mobility. They have better demographic outlooks now, even though they've in a sense been through their aging process and have managed to deal with it successfully. And also it seems that these egalitarian countries are more successful in implementing climate mitigation policies. And the key to this success seems to be that the Nordic countries have not pursued a simple reorientation strategy with their welfare systems towards more activation, but they have instead combined strong protection with heavy social investments with the aim to promote social equality as well as gender equality. And so they have pursued a very comprehensive strategy that invests in capacitating quality services, and I keep saying that word because here the issue is not just service provision, but it's quality service provisions, to support people throughout the life course, starting from early childhood education, through primary to college education, to lifelong training, and active labor market policies then throughout the life course, and which have sought to promote equality of access as well as equality of outcomes. And here a key finding from our research is that not only do more equal societies almost always do better, and here I'm quoting the title of a book by Wilkinson and Pickett, but egalitarian systems are also the ones that appear to be the most innovative and competitive in the world economy. I'll skip through, there are some critiques, of course, that have been raised at the social investment perspective. There are five kind of broad critiques, and some, in a sense, could be said to be related more to the kind of implementation that we have seen so far, which has been very much partial, as I mentioned. So these kind of main criticism is one, a critique that the strategy's focus on the future means that today's poor are being left aside. The focus is more on reaping benefits in the future, on preventing the transmission of poverty for children of the future, but that this might mean a reorientation of social spending today from the poor towards services that might benefit the rich better, such as childcare services, which might be more beneficial to two-income families, which already have higher incomes. There's also a critique with the focus on activation, where some argue that this focus has offered a justification for cutting back benefits that previously allowed certain groups to remain outside the labor market, and typically lone parents, for example. There's been a strong move towards activating this kind of this group. Then there's a critique that the social inclusion, social cohesion aspect has not been taken seriously enough in the implementation of a strategy at the EU level, but again, that's a problem more of implementation. more central, perhaps, and more core critiques of this approach. There's been the feminist critique, which has argued that there's a kind of instrumentalization of gender equality policies in this perspective. The argument has not been that one should develop work-life policies for the sake of women to respond to their aspirations, but actually that it's been transformed into an economic argument. It's to raise women's employment rates. It's also to raise their fertility rates, so that there's been a bit of an instrumentalization. And there's been a similar critique saying that there's also been a kind of economicization of the argument, where the focus is also not on so much on children, but on kind of on citizen workers of the future rather than on citizen children of the present. So viewing children more as becomings, as future workers who we have to invest in, rather than as children with their own rights. So these are the kind of critiques. And this, we argue, and I won't have time to go over it, that it's partly linked to the kind of ambiguities that are linked to the social investment perspective. As I said, it comes from proponents. There are kind of neoliberal economists, as well as more kind of social democratic policy analysts, etc., who have kind of been promoting the social investment perspective. And so some of these ambiguities and tensions can be traced to these kind of dual backgrounds. And what we see is that in Europe, there's been really two approaches. There's the third way approach that has been put forward, most notably by Anthony Giddens, and promoted then through the government of Tony Blair. But then there's also the Nordic social democratic approach. And what we see is actually that social democratic approach is the one that is functioning best. So this for the critique, and just a last word perhaps on is there any future for the social investment strategy in Europe? There seems to be a growing consensus now, even amongst neoliberal economists who had been trying to promote budget cuts in the UK and in the US and elsewhere, that this is actually now this strategy has now run into the wall, so to speak, and that now it's important that that governments start investing again, and mostly that they start investing in human capital. One can also learn from the experience of Finland and Sweden, who both went through a very deep economic crisis in the 1990s, and the kind of strategy they developed when facing this crisis. Finland was the first to be hit by the crisis, and what it did was to introduce very severe cuts in the public sector, in social benefits. And the result was actually that this fueled a downward employment spiral, resulting in unemployment levels that reached up to 20%. So in Sweden, the crisis came a little later, and the governments decided to learn from the Finnish experience. And what they did is that they also phased in some cuts, but much more gradually. They also raised taxes gradually, and they also were more careful into where they implemented cuts. So what they did is they implemented a 10% cut across the board in all the in all social benefits, so insurance-based benefits, but they decided to maintain spending on childcare and education and healthcare services, with the argument that other insurance-based benefits could always be raised again once they were out of a crisis. But if you did not invest in childcare and health, you had a generation that would be affected very negatively for the future, and that would affect actually employment prospects in the long run. So there was a very kind of careful way of looking at where cuts were implemented. And also, but even retrospectively, the Ministry of Finance concluded that they had been too harsh in the kind of benefit cuts that had been implemented, and that it had prolonged the employment crisis more than was necessary. also in Sweden and in Finland, in both cases, during the crisis, they invested massively in adult education to try and retrain the labor force to adapt them to the new economic needs. And in Sweden, they had this knowledge lift program, which allowed unemployed persons to complete a secondary education degree while receiving unemployment benefits, and that was also quite successful in leading to the transition. And finally, a final argument in favor of a social investment strategy is that the countries that are facing the worst crisis today are those who did not invest in the past, and those who are doing quite well are those who invested. So that might be a good reason for doing that. For those who want the more empirical data and all this is what I was talking about is based on a book that you have there.
Bueno, pues a mí en primer lugar me gustaría agradecer a Natalie el esfuerzo que ha hecho para sintetizar una presentación que era un poquito más larga, y no sé si alguien del público quisiera hacer alguna pregunta. Fernando.
Sí, hola. Se ha dicho que se ha dicho.
No. I don't have the translation, sorry. Yeah, I think now I have it.
Se ha dicho que las sociedades latinas, por decirlo así, como la nuestra, tienen un modelo de bienestar donde las ayudas familiares, los apoyos familiares y comunitarios son importantes, ¿no? Sabemos que estos apoyos familiares y comunitarios se han prestado con una gran inequidad de género, han sido prestados por las mujeres fundamentalmente, y además esos recursos han sido sobreexplotados de forma insensata, por decirlo así. Sin embargo, también sabemos o creemos que podemos tener una fortaleza, que quizás ese capital social, esas redes familiares comunitarias, pueden ser un ingrediente importante en un nuevo equilibrio, en un nuevo mix de bienestar, ¿no? La pregunta es, en el modelo que tú has presentado, ¿qué papel tienen o qué importancia pueden tener estos elementos de capital social, de red comunitaria o de apoyos familiares?
I mean, social capital is obviously something that is very central to the social investment strategy. I think the way it has been conceptualized is not so much based actually on the family, it's based more on community developments, but that is more taking on from kind of some of the neoliberal paradigm from before. But regarding the kind of Spanish family system, I think, as you say, it provides perhaps some kind of cohesive dimension. But one issue that you're facing is you're not having children anymore. This is something that needs to be addressed somehow. And clearly, the kind of family policies that exist in Spain right now are not enabling families to do. And it's not just a question of Spanish people not wanting to have children anymore. I think when you look at international surveys, what is striking is that across all countries, the desired fertility is the same everywhere. It's about two children. But what's happening is that, you know, in some countries, and it's those that have underdeveloped social policies for supporting women's employment, also, you're not having children. So it might be good in terms of the social capital dimension of family model you have right now might work, but it's not sustainable in the long run because you're going to be extinguishing yourself by not reproducing also. I think in the social investment perspective, there's more this idea that one needs to look at the future sustainability of the welfare state by allowing people to have children.